7 years old, I was cast as Punky Brewster.
There were 12 kids in the business. We all knew everyone.
I carried a camera with me everywhere I went. This is the first time I'm watching the tapes back.
I can't believe you have this.
Learning who I was, that was with you.
Big question is, what happens once I unlock the vault?
Hello, and happy International Women's Day from us at ATX TV and Hulu. Today we're celebrating two things we love, moms and 90s TV. I'm Caitlin McFarland, this is Emily Gibson. We are the co-founders of ATX TV, and we are thrilled to continue our partnership with Hulu this week for all things 90s television.
Anyone that is familiar with us knows that we're big into nostalgia. Reunions and celebrating the past is kind of our sweet spot.
And beyond that, we are unabashedly children of the 90s. It may be dating ourselves, but I don't care. We grew up watching and loving and ultimately being taught by all the 1990s TV greatness from comedies and dramas, TGIF and beyond. So this week, when Hulu said they were celebrating the 90s, we were so in. Be sure to check out a week of programming and events, including our trivia game night on Wednesday, and their doc Kid 90 on Friday.
And in celebration of 90s week, I had my mom send me my high school letter jacket from the 1990s.
Yeah.
To be fair, I think it was also my sister's letter jacket and then mine. So it got a lot of good use in the 90s.
Letter jackets, just like, you know, they started in the 50s and then everybody had them. I didn't, but everybody had them.
It's an authentic 1990s letter jacket that, you know, is pretty comfortable here. Right. And then I have one other thing to show. If you're from Texas, you will understand this.
Mom.
Homecoming. Mm-hmm. A homecoming mom. That's right. You would wear these at homecoming. They've got all the bells. Fall 1999.
Just for everybody to have the record, not only did I not have a letter jacket, I did not have one of those, but my school also didn't have football, so it kind of wasn't a Texas high school in that sense, and I find them ridiculous and hilarious.
All true things. So thank you, Mom, for sending these to me so that I could wear them this week. And in honor of you and all of the 90s moms, we are very proud to be hosting this panel of some pretty classic 90s shows. From Family Matters to Wonder Years, Moesha to Dawson's Creek and Doogie Howser MD, these moms are phenomenal. We have series that spanned the full decade, and we're pretty beside ourselves to revisit with these amazing women, along with our own moms.
Well, let's get on with it. I just can't wait any longer. Please enjoy our panel, Mother Knows Best, moderated by People's Breanne Heldman and presented with Hulu.
Hi, everyone. I am Breanne Heldman from People Magazine, and I am so excited to introduce this panel. It's kind of an insane grouping of 90s moms that I feel helped raise me and probably, if you're watching, helped raise you. First up, we have Mary-Margaret Humes, AKA Gail Leery from Dawson's Creek.
Good morning.
Then we've got JoMarie Payton, AKA Harriette Winslow from Family Matters.
Hi, family.
Beautiful. And we have Sheryl Lee Ralph, AKA D. Mitchell from Moesha.
Mo to the, E to the.
E to the. Very nice, very nice. And next we have Belinda Montgomery, AKA Katherine Howser from Doogie Howser MD.
Hello, hello, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone.
And the one that's going to make my parents cry when they watch this, Allie Mills, AKA Norma Arnold from Wonder Years.
Hello, everybody. Well, you heard me say that anyway.
So I'm going to start with an easy one, and that is, what do you love looking back about these moms? And we'll start with Mary-Margaret.
Oh, gosh. I think what I liked about our show was it was before the internet. It was just at the birth of the internet, so we weren't distracted by, is somebody gonna get a text message in the middle of a take? Or when we were in between takes, we had conversations back and forth, you know, just gazing into each other's eyes and really communicating like human beings used to do, you know? So it was really good that we were sequestered away in Wilmington, North Carolina, away from the limelight and the glitz and the, you know, the glory of Hollywood. And we could just breathe life, authentic life into these characters for everybody.
Awesome. Belinda, you're up.
Well, you know, in the late 80s and the 90s, we had a totally different sensibility, absolutely. When we were doing Doogie, you know, we were on a soundstage, and as, you know, as Mary-Margaret said, we didn't have the internet. Kids won't believe that we didn't have the internet, but we didn't. We had real life situations, whatever that was during the time. And, you know, when I look at then and now, and I'm looking at the shows that are on now, they're so progressive. And we have so many kids from so many different walks of life that we just didn't portray back then. So we were homemakers in the 80s and 90s, and we also encroached on a working life. We would be working moms now and then, but mostly we were at home. So I don't have kids myself. I just rented them on all these shows. But, you know, I think we made an impact because people would tell us, all of us, I think, you know, what it meant for them to see an episode and what they got out of it. And I'd always be thrilled and astonished. But today is a totally different place. And I look back on that and it's like looking back on the 1920s from the 1970s. You know, you sort of go, wait a minute, what did you do that? You couldn't do this, you know? So yeah, we had a lot of fun. And I think we had a lot of lessons for the kids at that time that were heartfelt.
Absolutely. I definitely want to get into some of those lessons a little later, but Sheryl, tell us about what you loved about your character. Oh,
I loved my character because Dee wasn't the regular kind of mom. Dee was a stepmom. She married a man that she fell in love with at a student teacher meeting because she was principal of the high school. And before you knew it, she was an incoming freshman's mom. And there started some of the best relationships and lessons in life ever. I thought they were brilliant when I was reading the scripts because the show, Moesha, was so well written. But when now, all these years later, I walk down the street wherever I am in the world and somebody will say, Moesha. And when people say to you, thank you for helping me learn how to raise my child, it's just such a legacy of life, of learning, of art truly impacting life. And I love the legacy of the little series that still changes people today and is gaining a brand new audience. That's the great part. A 9-year-old came up to me and he looked at me, he crossed his arms and he looked at me from my head to my toes and he said, you are on Moesha. I like you. And I was like, my God.
That's so awesome. I want to talk about just because of streaming and all of these shows are available on Hulu, you guys are having these new audiences and people are coming up to you 30 years later talking about these characters and the things that these moms have taught them. What is that like for you, Allie?
Well, for me, unlike the other shows that are in the 80s, our show then went back another 20 years to the 60s, because our show was a flashback show. So I was in that vein of women who grew up in the late 40s and 50s. So becoming, you know, I was a homemaker too in the show, but just beginning to hear about women becoming, you know, women's lib and women standing up for themselves. And so I think that's the major thing for me was the whole change of what women thought. I mean, I back in the 60s, I was my daughter on the show. I was a crazy hippie, you know, Volkswagen van like she was. And I didn't appreciate you know, I kind of was rebelling against the women that I saw that were homemakers. I thought, you know, get me out of here. I want to live. I want to, you know, I felt like it was constricted, the 50s moving into the 60s. But what happened to me is I developed such an appreciation for the selflessness of these women, because their job really was to give, you know, to make the family happy, she cared about her husband, her children. And that's the major thing that people come and talk to me about is, you know, appreciating the role of a homemaker, just in a period of time when we're now kind of disdainful about it, sort of, you know, as if sometimes people apologize, well, I'm just a homemaker. I don't have a job. And
that's a big job, baby.
Hey, that's a great job.
Yep.
So I think that's, you know, probably all of us, you know, 80s, but also especially in the women that were just coming out of the 50s, you know, my mother was one of the first people I knew in my neighborhood that she worked full time. Like everybody else was at home, and she was kind of ostracized. She was also divorced, but ostracized, you know.
That's interesting. That's interesting that you say that, because growing up, I never knew a woman who did not work. Mm-hmm. Everybody I knew, everybody in the community, they worked. All those women worked at something for someone, or they had their own business. So that's very interesting.
Aha. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Totally different perspective, huh? Yeah.
JoMarie, you know, speaking of really being this powerhouse that brought the family together, you, Harriette brought Urkel into the family. It was defending Urkel even to the family. What did you learn from her and from her openness?
What I learned from her was what I learned from my mother and my grandmother, that respect is important, especially coming from children. The kids on my show were good kids. They were very respectful, unlike some of the kids we have now that are rude and disrespectful. My kids were good kids, the kids on the shows, and it's because their parents demanded that they be respectful to adults. Right now, those kids are grown right now, and they're still respectful. I think it's one of the things that people that meet me in the streets, and the show has never been off the air, that meet me in the street, meet me with such high regards, and the first thing they want from me, after they say hello or scream or whatever they're gonna do, they want a hug. Even in the COVID area, they still want a hug. You know, so let's do it like this right here. You know, we got the mask on. And all because they want a certain amount of structure. Family Matters was a show that structured people, you know? Our kids didn't dress any kind of way. They came in there dressed decently, but we were in that era also, you know? So even when I run into kids in the streets and they have the pants hanging off the butt, because some of them still do that, and they got the tattoos all over their arms or whatever, and they see me, they say, yo, 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 Harriette, and they're looking all crazy, but I love them wherever they are. Because inside of that exterior is still somebody that had a grandmother and a mother that taught them something that was good that they'll be able to reach back to later on to get and maybe put it into their children. So it was important for me to give them an example of what I learned, because we were that kind of show too. Give them an example or show them what my mother and my grandmother showed me. It's what I try to show my granddaughter right now. You know, it's what I showed my daughter. And I'm proud to say that she's never been to jail. She's not on drugs, not that I know of, you know. She has a decent job. She never gave me any problems in college that I knew of, you know. And all because I probably would go back there and whoop her. But at any rate, it was a wonderful experience for me. And whenever I felt like they were getting out of line, I remember asking the producers if I could ask the parents if I could talk to the kids. And this was early on in the show. And they said, sure, if their parents say you can, you can. And one of the first conversations I had with those kids, and it was after Urkel came on, that they needed to behave, but I also told them that they were not to go out there and tell our business to the press. I said, the same way your mama, your daddy tell you, don't go out there and tell my business, don't go out there telling your business to the press. Don't tell them nothing, is what I told them, you know.
JoMarie was a trailblazer with, like, the spoiler threats. Before there were blogs, like, with lots and lots of photos teasing all of everything that's going to happen on the show.
Right, but let me say one other thing, too. Well, let me say one other thing, because I want to piggyback up what Sheryl said. Harriet Winslow was a hardworking mother. And like Sheryl said, we grew up and everybody we knew worked. My mother worked, and she wasn't supposed to work because we were on welfare. I'm one of nine. I was the oldest girl, six brothers, and two sisters. My mother was not supposed to be working. My mother said, I'll be darned if anybody tell me I can't go to work, because what they give me is not enough to feed my children. So my mother worked every day except Sunday. Everybody worked. We didn't steal. You know what I mean? Yeah. I've never been on welfare, thank God. But we worked.
It's amazing. It is really remarkable to look at these moms. And it's so interesting now with streaming, so many people rediscovering it. Mary-Margaret, I'm curious what that is like for you when the fans are the same age they were when Dawson's was on.
Oh, I know. It's really, really strange because the same thing that the other ladies were saying is that I get the same response. I wish you had been my mom. I think of you as my mom. And, you know, chronologically, I am old enough to have been any of their mothers on the show. But as far as maturity level or maternal authority figure, I probably wasn't. I was more of a friend to these kids. You know, we would hang out on the weekends, and I don't think they actually thought of me as being, you know, older and wiser. They thought of me as being a surrogate mom, or like what the producers would call me, their den mother. I think the most mommy thing that I ever did on this show was I was always around set with my little Instamatic camera. Do you guys remember those?
Mm-hmm.
The little Instamatic before we had cell phone cameras. And then I would have my video camera with me all the time. And I told the kids, the reason I'm taking all these pictures is because one day you're going to want to show this to your grandkids. We're going to put together a fabulous photo album. And they thought I was absolutely crazy. And I was probably annoying to them. But, you know, they went along with it. And now, you know, 20 years later, on Instagram, talking about social media, I've been able to put some old pictures of us behind the scenes from Dawson's Creek so that everybody who loved the show back then and who love it now can see what it was actually like to live with us, to breathe, you know, the air with us on the weekends when we'd go to the beach or go jet skiing or go bowling. And at the time, they gave me a little bit of stuff about it, but now everybody really enjoys it. I'm glad that I did that. So it's like when you go places, not that we can go too many places now, but people recognize me. It's like, aren't you on Dawson's Creek? And I'm like, well, how do you remember that? And it's like, oh no, we're rewatching it. So it's not just the 20-year-olds who are watching it, like what you asked. It's their parents are watching it again with their own kids. Because, you know, it's a way to communicate and talk about, you know, the sex that was on our show. And a lot of the parents told me it was one of the favorite things about watching the show with the parents and the kids together was that it opened up a dialogue for something that was taboo to be talking about. So it's just the show that was it was the end of innocence and the beginning of everything else. And I think, you know, when Kevin Williamson wrote this, he had no idea it was going to be living, you know, the life that it has had. So, I mean, I'm grateful to have been the mom there.
We had the same sort of thing with Moesha, you know, talking about sex, talking about racism, talking about death, talking about, you know, what it is to create a blended family. And it was an interesting thing with Dee, my character on the show, my mom. She was a boundary setter. She set boundaries. She was a strict mother. But it was strict with love. When the show first came out, oh my God, the young people who watched the show couldn't tell me enough on the street, why does Dee have to be so mean? Why is she always telling them they can't do this, they can't do that, they shouldn't be dressing that way, or they should be careful about the things that come out of their mouth. It is amazing, now that the show is being streamed around the world, how those children who are now adults, some of them with children of their own, they're like, I get it, I understand. It's hard being a mother. It's hard setting boundaries. How do you do it? Can you tell me one more time how to do it? It is amazing. They didn't understand when they were young, but they sure get it now that they're older. They know how to be a good parent, especially a good mother.
Mm-hmm. And what Mary-Margaret was saying, because I'm ADD, so if I get a thought, it will disappear in about 10 seconds. When you said that your show is a show that families can watch with their kids, mm-hmm. I have 9 grandchildren. Parents rarely ever watch anything with their kids anymore. And it's such a shame. I mean, I think that the 80s was kind of the end of that.
Yeah.
You know, shows that were about families, you watched with your family. And I hope that they're doing that again on Hulu. I haven't had anybody tell me that they're watching it with their family. But that's what's so great about all of these shows is you watch it and then people used to talk afterwards. That's right. What they told me back, you know, when we were on in the 80s,
right.
Is they had family conversations about the lesson of the show and argue and discuss and stuff like that. I know, JoMarie, you said that when we were on a panel like 10 years ago together, the doctors, but you were saying that, you know, it's the lessons learned in these shows really affected families. And what a amazing thing that is for television to be that kind of a tool. And we are all lucky enough to be on shows that were really well written. I mean, most shows are not well written. And that's why I think these ones have lasted. The writing was so good on all of them.
Excellent.
And made people think about families and raising them and mothers working, not working, you know, Shirley was saying.
Our shows, all of these shows, and I watched all of you guys' shows too, made people care about people.
Yeah.
And that's why people are gravitating to them now. And that's why they're streaming now and they're so historical and people love them so much because we cared about each other. We're at a place right now, people need to be more compassionate with each other, need to care about each other.
Amen.
I facilitate a after school program for the last 2 years I've been doing it with teenagers after school program in theater, arts. And those kids, the way I have to deal with those kids now is that I don't do the mommy thing or the grandma thing with them, although they like the sugar mama thing. I'm more their friend. I'm more their friend now than a parent because a lot of them are in trouble about a lot of things that they're going through with social media and a whole bunch of other things and, you know, growing up in general. So I learned years ago that in order to touch these teenagers now, I have to be more their friend than their parent because I feel like kids that are in the middle of the road or that are having problems have to have somewhere to go. Because I believe deep down inside of all of us, there's something good. And somebody needs to be receptive of that and see you beyond what you project. Because a lot of kids are just following the footsteps of other kids just to be a part of something good or either bad. Most times it's bad. And but inside, there's some good there. And so if it's there, I want it. So I'll look at them and say, ooh, I like that tattoo. That's one too many, though. You know what I'm saying? That's one too many. I kind of like that. You know, I have to use a different kind of psychology on these kids. And when they walk in and all, and they appreciate that. And I love it if I walk in and I see on the blackboard, we love you, Miss Joe, because that's what they call me, Miss Joe. And because I told them, they got to put a handle on my name. Don't call me JoMarie because I don't answer. You can call me JoMarie all day long. If I'm old enough to be your mama, I will not answer you. But if you say Miss Joe or Miss Payton, Nana, call me anything, but you cannot call me by my first name like I'm on your level because I'm not. I demand respect. And everything, and I want it, and I will get it, you know. And I do.
Now you've made me nervous to call you JoMarie.
It's not a style. Call me Joe.
Well, but speaking of kind of the amazing lessons that these shows brought, we're now living in this era of revivals and reboots, and all of your shows at various points have been discussed as those, JoMarie, I know you said you and your cast said in 2017 during that EW reunion that you guys would be totally up for a revival. Is that still true? Has there been any movement on that?
You know what? I would love to do a revival. I don't have a problem with it as far as getting back in it and being with everybody. But for me, and I said it on another interview I did, it doesn't feel like we're actually doing the show if they don't bring closure to the way that I left the show. If I start the show, get in the show again, and I'm happy with it where it is. If they pick it up, they don't pick it up, I'm still okay. I'm gonna eat. But they took my youngest daughter away. I have to answer for that almost 350 days of the year. I have to answer for where my baby daughter went. And that still bothers me to this day. Because if they had taken away my teenage daughter, then people could have said, oh, well, where's Laura? Oh, Laura's with her friends or whatever. But you took the baby girl. And then when I went in to ask you why you took the baby girl, you told me nobody was going to notice. And everybody noticed that she went upstairs and she didn't come back down. Okay? So I said, well, then you guys need to tell me something either creatively or politically correct. Because I have to answer that. They said, nobody's going to care. I said, they don't know you. They're not going to ask you. They're going to ask me. What happened to her? Why did I let that happen? So that still bothers me. And I did mention that if I came back to do the show, they had another Harriet. They call her back. But if I come back and do it, you got to make her come from up them stairs. She got to come downstairs. Even if she's bring her back from upstairs to downstairs. Let's do that
thing. I feel like even just a half hour special with that moment would be massive.
I'm trying to make it happen. Trying to make it happen.
Belinda, how do you feel about Doogie Howser being redone? If, for anyone watching who doesn't know, it is being kind of rebooted entirely, starring Peyton Elizabeth Lee from Andy Mack, who is awesome. She's an amazing young actress, I have to tell you. So it's in good hands as far as that's concerned. But what do you think about that?
I don't know. When we started it, it was like the late 80s. It was 1988 or something. I had just finished doing Aaron's Way with Merlin Olsen for NBC, and I was an Amish mom. And then I go from that to playing a genius's mother. And before that, it was Miami Vice with Don Johnson and with his kid. And with Miami Vice, I wanted to be a cop. I wanted to be out there on the streets. And they looked at me, they said, you can't do that. I said, of course I can. I can be tough. They went, oh no. So I ended up being, his wife. And I said, but that's not gonna last. Be Don Johnson's wife in this, forget it. And of course that was just crazy. For Doogie, Stephen Bochco put it together and it was such a great idea. But it was so crazy. I mean, this kid who's like 15 and is a doctor and working in a hospital, we went, well, we'll shoot the pilot. That'll be fun. And it's really nice working with my friends and Larry Pressman and James Sicking. And that's it, right? And then when it was picked up and it was on for like 4 or 5 years or whatever, we were really shocked and pleased. At the end of every show, he would type in his computer, which we thought was amazing. He would type a little story about what happened during that week and sum it all up. And it was a great lesson for kids. And I mean, I have people telling me now how much they loved that show and they relied on it. So yeah, a reboot would probably be, it would be terrific. It'd be totally different. I mean, this was cutting edge because me being the mother of a genius, I'm not about to give him a lot of advice. Because, it was really hard to tell him anything because he knew everything. All I could do in the morning was give him some cold pizza and warm it up for him. What? And then at the end, they wanted to have me in the hospital more because we used to do all our scenes at home. And of course, they had all the hospital stuff. So they were making me a volunteer at the hospital and going to start working there, which I was very happy about because I said, women can do other things. Other than being in the home and making food every day. So we got that and Sheryl Lee and JoMarie got that going. Yep. I think we all got that going in some way after, but this was traditional and Allie, looking back on the 60s, you're right. I mean, it was such a progression to where we were in the 90s. And when I'm looking at the shows now and seeing the content and what they're about, it covers all aspects of life and generations and gender. Gender is a big deal, but it's not because we're addressing it in all these shows. And I think that's just terrific. And plus the fact, how many cable shows are out there? I mean, there are shows that have won Emmys and they're in their fifth season. I didn't even know they were on the air, you know? So I guess we're really lucky with that, because I don't know, when Allie and I were doing stuff, there were three networks and a little bit of cable, but that was it. So it's really exciting for young people now. If you're an actor now, don't you think? If you're 20 and an actor, you've really got anywhere you want to go.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Allie, I'm sure you know that Wonder Years is also getting a reimagining at the hands of Lee Daniels, which is going to, I think, going to be really
cool.
Yes. And I mean, I think it's a brilliant idea. I think, I'm not sure who came up with the idea. I think it might've been Saladin Patterson, who's the writer, who lived in the South and watched the Wonder Years. I'm pretty sure I've got this story right, although I may be making it up. But I think he used to watch it, and he wanted to do an African-American version of what life was like for him in 1968 in exactly the same kind of format. I don't know the format yet, if there's going to be a suburban house, or if they're going to make it like that, you know, mirror it, or if it's going to be inner city and tough. I mean, JoMarie, I'm embarrassed to say this, but as you were saying, and so are you, Sheryl, that most of the women that you knew worked, I didn't actually, I wondered, I don't know what the statistics are with, you know, with women that worked who were African-American back in the 40s, 50s, you know, if almost all of them worked. I mean, I'm embarrassed to say I didn't actually think about that. You know, I thought that probably people stayed home and watched their kids too, but people had to make a living.
Oh, a dollar an hour. My mother made a dollar an hour. She worked 8 hours a day. She made $1 an hour. She made extra money if her bosses had parties, and she stayed and she served and she did it, and she had a white blouse and a
My mom had a boutique.
My mom had a boutique. Her skill was sewing, and she would do fashion shows 4 times a year. And I remember the mayor's wife to come to her fashion show and buy clothing. So there was always work happening.
And where did you grow up, Sheryl?
I grew up between the West Indies and Connecticut, Waterbury.
Wow.
But if you go to West Indies, Jamaica, you have to go to Devonair's. That's her mother's ice cream place, and it has the best ice cream in the world. I think they massage the cows to get that taste.
I thought I heard Jamaica. I love Jamaica.
I love Jamaica.
It's so beautiful.
In Jamaica, we don't have one job. We have one, two, three jobs, because you're not human if you're not work. You must work.
Wow. So ladies, Sheryl. Yeah. And JoMarie, do you think it gave you a totally different outlook on life and work ethic? That, because you're so vibrant, the two of you have such an aura about you. Did you think you came in like exploding into the world and saying, yes, I'm going to take it over here in Hollywood? I mean, did you have a different kind of an attitude, do you think, than other people, because you saw how work gets you somewhere?
No, not really, because I think I always, people ask me, how did I get in show business? I said, it got into me, because when I was growing up, I was the only girl for 10 years. I didn't have a sister or a girl cousin. So I had these imaginary friends. And I remember I loved Myrna Loy, and I loved Loretta Young coming down the stairs, these beautiful dresses and things. And I could draw, you know, and I could sing, and I could do all these different things. And I was everybody's little miss whatever. And my mother worked for the Ackermans, who were Jewish people on Miami Beach. And every time they went on trips, because I was the only girl, they fell in love with me. So every trip they went on, they would bring me back an outfit from that country. Japan, they bring me back little wooden shoes, little Japanese. If they went to, what's the Dutch place with the little wooden, those little wooden shoes.
Yeah, yeah.
And they did that up until the time I was 12 years old. So I had these outfits. So I was always acting out stuff and singing and doing things. But I knew when my mom and dad broke up, right after I was 12 years old, and I always saw my mother work, but I saw how hard she worked after they split. I knew nobody was gonna give me anything. By the same token, my parents always told us, I will help you get out of anything that I can help you get out of. but I will not help you if you steal. So I don't think I ever stole a piece of candy in my life. I just never wanted anything so bad that I would steal it. I never knew anybody that had something that I wanted so bad that I wanted to take it or possess it. What I wanted was something better. And I knew if I was going to get anything better, I had to get it myself. So yeah. That's where my work ethic came from. I always tell
you. How about stealing scenes, JoMarie?
Okay.
He's so good at that.
one of my messages is to young people now, you know, that are so headstrong on, I got to get this and I got to have that and I got to have this car and that house and this, that and the other. I said, been there, done that, moving on. I said, but the key to it is not getting it, it's keeping it. And whatever you had to get what you had before, you still have it to get it again, but your priorities change in life.
Right.
I don't want the things I had earlier in life. Mm-hmm. And I want to be healthy. I want my family to be healthy.
And how about you, Sheryl Lee?
For me, it's a little different because, okay, I'm going to talk about the Emmys. So early in my career, it was, I got there at the time that such a road had been built for me by so many other actresses of color, especially Black actresses before me, that I was able to go from one series to the next, Mm-hmm. And Moesha was like the third. And I wanted to go to the Emmys. And I remember when people would say things to you like, well, why do you want to go to the Emmys? It's not like you're nominated. It's not like you'll be nominated. Not like you will win. And it was like the industry wanted to tell you the barriers that were set up there before you. But I so was enamored by Tinkerbell going around that steeple that I knew it was possible. I knew I could. A 64 Mustang, even though by the time I grew up, it was an old car, I remember that it was all possible. So mm-hmm. when I looked at the Emmys, the Golden Globes that just happened, and I saw Andra Day win, behind her came Regina King, and the way they embraced each other as brothers and sisters, I was like, see, that's what I'm talking about, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was an amazing moment.
One, but they won, and I get to shine in that light. So show business is my life. I love show business. The small screen, streaming, doing what we're doing now. Nobody was ever going to stop me from doing this, even if I had to work twice as hard for half a chance.
It's the element. It's the element. It's your element. When it's your element, you always want to be in it.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. How about you, Allie? Oh, wait a minute. I'm not asking the question.
No, you go ahead. I'm good. I'm just sitting here having a lovely time.
ask me about a reading. Yes. Come on.
What about you, Mary?
Well, yeah. So I feel like nobody really talks about a Dawson's reboot except people fantasize about it. What have you heard? Has there been anything official, any real conversations?
Oh, well, the $6 million question, right? Not that I don't get asked that every single day of my life. Well, there has been a secret text message going around between all we actors. Kevin Williamson, of course, has been busy doing other shows. Katie Holmes and I have talked about it extensively. James Vanderbeek and I have talked about it. I actually wrote like 190 pages of an idea for a crossover to a reboot. Whether it goes anywhere, I don't know, but there's certainly a lot of buzz about it. I think what they have expressed is our show was so much simpler than what television is now, again, because of social media. And it's like you can actually do a show and not make any references to social media. We can pick up where we left off and just let that element be there, but not be so predominant. So as far as I know, personal information from the kids, there's a strong possibility. I'd like to keep that hope alive for everybody because the fans are clamoring for it, and they want to live the simpler life that we had back in 1998. So fingers crossed, we'll see.
Wow. Well, I confess I'm actually in the middle of a re-binge of Dawson's myself. And speaking of moms who work, the last episode I watched was the one where Gail got offered another job. Season three, Gail got offered another job to go back to reporting. She was back from Philadelphia, struggling to get a job, now working to start to open the restaurant. And then Principal Green left. And she did an amazing report. It was actually a beautiful episode for Gail and Dawson. And then she left, and it was really poignant to me, and I thought very interesting actually to bring up with this group, because she kind of ends that storyline with this line of, I wanted to leave on my own terms.
Right.
And I thought that was really beautiful. And I know JoMarie and Sheryl Lee, like, you both kind of left your shows on somewhat of your own terms.
You
lived that.
On my own terms, because initially my contract, I lived out my contract and I didn't want to do the show again. And so when it went from ABC to CBS, and a lot was asked to come back, and initially I was guaranteed all shows, whether I did one line or 100 shows, every show that was done, I was guaranteed it. When it came to CBS, then they wanted to cut the shows, and I wasn't happy with that. I still wanted to be paid for all shows. So what I did was I signed an agreement to do half of the shows when I went over to CBS, two on and two off, or two on, two off. And then we had a disagreement, and I had an option, which they say, we don't give artists options, is what the attorneys told me. We don't give options. I said, well, then I'm a free agent. I walked out the door. So they, a week later, they called me back and said, okay, we'll accept your option. I said, my option is to be able to get out clean if I want to, and that's what I did. I got out clean. That was it.
Amazing. Mm-hmm.
For me, leaving the show, it was very interesting, because we had such a wholesome, wonderful family, and the family dealt with all kinds of issues, as many families do still, but we dealt with it in a way that was had a foundation in love. And when the decision was made to turn what I felt my husband into a liar, meaning that what happened was a new character came into the show. We loved this character. It was his nephew. And then the script was written that it was really his son.
Oh.
And it's like, wait a minute. You're going to tell me that this boy has been living with us for a year and we've been having these wonderful moments as a family. So that means he's a liar. And my only question was, why? Why do this to the character? Why do this to the family? Why do this to the show? So a whole bunch of things ended up happening. Somebody got kidnapped. We still don't know what happened to Miles. Somebody ended up with a pregnancy test. I took a trip to Jamaica, and then I would just come back every month or so. And then I was like, oh, wow, this is too much. And then it was just uncomfortable. And I'm like, you know what? I love what I do, and I love when I'm able to do it happy. My goal in jobs, when I get them, is go to the set, do my job, leave, so I can come back happy, do it all over again.
Right.
So that's why I left, because it was for my peace of mind. My God, I feel like Meghan Markle. I had to leave the royal family. They were driving me crazy.
Oh, we are about to learn how really crazy they were driving her. But Sheryl Lee, you have not yet been in the hot seat about the reboot situation. And I know that actually Brandy talked about maybe being in talks of a reboot or a revival even just this past summer. Have you heard anything?
I have not heard about whether it's going to move forward or not, but I hear about this often. Would it be great? Absolutely. Would I be open to it? Absolutely. Just understand, I'm happy. I want to go to work happy. I want to leave work happy. Let's stay happy.
Hey, yes.
Why not do it?
So I want to do a couple of quick fires because we've only got about 10 minutes left. So we'll go Mary-Margaret, JoMarie, Sheryl Lee, Belinda, Allie, because that's the order that I see you in. And just make that easy. What's something from the 90s that you really do not miss?
Oh, goodness. What do I not miss? I didn't really enjoy the clothing. I'm much happier living kind of a boho style, you know, now, and not really caring. I just didn't like the clothing, the, you know, the big, big, you know, prom hair, you know, just the look of it, I guess.
JoMarie?
You know what? I'm going to agree with her. I didn't like the clothing. I didn't like all the stockings and all the tightened up. And we're starting to go back to this stuff, too. See this? I like freedom. especially at my age, because now that we have to put on the mask, and I don't have a problem with masks, I say, but you know, I can't not breathe there and can't breathe here either. Something got to give. So everything I have on is just free flowing, just like me. It's just free flowing. So it was a cloak.
Remember the shoulder pads we
had? Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow. We look like football.
I agree with her. Everything else about the 90s, I just live life the way it's put out there to me. I just live it.
Sheryl,
I do not miss the Walkman. I do not miss the Walkman. I don't care what they said about the Walkman. Every time you put your Walkman on and you tried to run, it would still skip. So I do not miss the mini little digital thing that it went to. I do not miss the Walkman. I don't miss any of that technology of the 90s. I love the technology that we have now, though, but it's just a little bit complicated. Mm-hmm.
No, that's a great answer. Belinda, I mean, what do you miss or not miss?
From the 90s, I look back at older shows, and my hair was naturally very, very curly. And so I could just wash it and scrunch. And I loved that. But I'm looking back, and I look like a poodle. I'm looking there, and I've got this hair. And my husband looks at it and goes, what's with the hair? I went, no, we all did that. But mm-hmm. I look at it and it just looks, you know, it's like bizarre. So I don't miss that. I don't miss, you're right, the Walkman, faxes, silly things that make that awful sound. I'm not very, you know, wonderful with all the digital stuff. But luckily, my husband is a digital genius and has an IT consulting business. So I'm really a dope. If he were ever to leave me, I'd have to marry somebody else that had an IT business. No, I'm not. I don't miss all that. And I'm not really adept with that. But I love the fact that here we all are, all these wonderful women, and we would not be here together from our homes enjoying this conversation. I mean, I had a bit of coffee. We wouldn't be doing this in normal times. So is this going to be the new normal for all of us? Maybe. Mm-hmm. Getting together like this, all the interviews. What do you think, Allie? What am I doing now?
No, go ahead, Allie, answer that. And then I want to hear what you don't miss from the 90s.
Well, you know, when you say the 90s, though, for me, it's funny. I don't think of... I don't think of decades, I guess.
Yeah.
I got married in the 90s. So when you said that, I miss everything from the 90s. Because that's when I first got married. I had not been married. I was 41. And, you know, God brought me the love of my life. And so I was
How did you escape? How did you escape to be 41 and not married?
I was wild.
You were?
I was wild. I was a 60s girl. 60s hippie, and
me too.
Almost my whole college class, nobody got married. It was weird. I mean, away, we were all 40 and single. It was crazy. I was a Roe v. Wade baby. I graduated in 73. And like I was saying, unlike the women I'd seen that were kind of grown up in the white neighborhoods anyway in the 50s, who I felt were constricted, I was just out. I went to New York City, got my apartment in New York City, you know, became an actress in New York City. It was like, the world is my oyster. But then I met, you know, I met someone in 1990. And so the 90s for me, I miss everything.
You have my heart, because I loved your husband too. But I had in 70, 80, 90, and in the 20s. And you all just saw him pass by here earlier this evening.
You're not sick of him, are you, JoMarie?
Not yet.
Okay. JoMarie knows that I lost my husband this year. So
yes, I'm so sorry to hear that.
Yeah, so it's been on top of COVID, it's been an extremely interesting year of isolation, you know, because grief is its own train. But I've never been on that kind of grief train. I've missed, you know, I've lost only parents. But you know, the other thing when Mary-Margaret was talking about television being, you know, television shows that were, wait a second, I'm sort of losing my train of thought, because it was about quality of shows. You were talking about Dawson's Creek, just a simpler life. That's right. You were just talking about being back to a simpler life. I feel like COVID has, I think it's made a lot of people stop and think about a simpler life.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, so like, and I think all of our shows, because they're older, were really about families, which is a simpler life.
Yes.
And I hope that may be one of the great outcomes of this extremely strange time period. I hope we do not end up in Zoom. I don't like this universe. Mm-hmm. I love human beings. I miss them so much. I'm like, JoMarie, I'm a hugger. I so miss being able to hug everybody. And
I miss that physical thing.
Yeah, but I think that, you know, I think hopefully people are going to want to go back to, you know, I'm growing vegetables in my backyard in Venice, California.
I love it.
I'm cooking them.
Yeah.
So, you know, and I miss that. I think that people might be rethinking, because now they're home and maybe they're going to stay home and be around, you know, their husband 24 hours a day, JoMarie.
And their kids. People around their kids now, much more so than they ever were. And it's good and bad, but I think it probably is mostly good if you like your kids, because you have a different relationship, right? Because they're always either on their phones or their iPad. And, you know, if you have a mealtime and you make the kids come, and I know my nephew's doing that with his kids, and they have a great relationship going that they may not have had at another time. I mean, that's got to be a positive for COVID. If we don't die, then that's a positive, you know?
We're not going to die. We're not going to die.
Right.
And how about the pets? The pets love having us at home. My husband and I, we walk our dog Bailey every day, and we see all these people out that we hadn't seen before COVID with their pets.
Oh, yeah.
They're usually working. The pets are going to be so upset if people go back to work.
I don't think I can ever go back to work again, because Rosie is 10 months old and she's only ever known us 24/7. If we need to go in another room, she's anxious. She goes, what? What about me? What am I, chopped liver?
So, Absolutely.
Tell you a COVID story. When it first happened, and my granddaughter, I would see her almost every day. Every other day, I would see my granddaughter. I only have one daughter and one granddaughter. So she has this Jones for me. It's like a drug we got, you know? So when COVID came in, I told them to stay home. So she said, well, why do we have to stay home? I said, because you might be a carrier. And so my daughter was doing all my shopping for me and everything and bringing it in.
Oh, yeah.
And I said, you guys like to go to the beauty supply place too much. You like to go too many places. So don't come over here. So then I felt bad. And I said, well, I have to go out and go get my meds. So I went to CVS and I just gave them a hit. I went to CVS and then I said, well, let me stop by the house and see them. So I stopped by there on that Sunday. They were all crazy and happy and everything. Uh-huh. And I said, well, you're not going to stay long. I'm going home. I went home. That was Sunday. That Monday, my granddaughter, Cameron, she said, Grandma, can we come to your house? I said, no. So she said, why? I said, because you might give me COVID. So she said, I heard my daughter in the back. And she said, just like this, tell your grandmother we don't have no damn COVID.
Oh, dear.
Yeah. You know, we have
so
a conscious bar
to all of us talk. That's how shows are going to change. Yes. That's exactly how shows are going to change. Everything that we're talking about is what is going to be the birth of these new shows.
That's right. We
have the longevity that we have.
Right.
Because people are now going to rediscover their family. They're going to rediscover themselves. They're going to have relationships with their children. I think we've seen in the past 10 years that a lot of series now about families, they're all fragmented. Everybody's having problems. Everybody is stressed. Everybody is looking for themselves. Everybody is looking for something. Everybody is battling a disease. And it has, for a lot of people watching TV, it has weighed them down. So people, I believe, now are going to turn, like we're all doing, turn inwards to find where is the good in the intimacy that we have had to discover as people, as family, as a community. And I think that's going to lead us into more series about the love that all of us shared in all of our shows.
From your lips to God's ears, please.
And also, I think we've got a lot of young filmmakers that are trying to figure out how to make films and series themselves because they're at home and they're playing with all the gear. And so we're going to see a whole onslaught of 20-somethings with, directors and writers, and we're going to be stunned at what they come up with. We're already starting to see it on cable. Because they're able to sell their shows. So
I think to connect with what you just said, I think COVID is going to reshape the way a lot of our series are seen.
Right.
I mean, and quite literally the scenes and how the scenes are shot, because due to COVID, those close-ups that we used to have, the way, they used to put down those tracks and take the camera right to you.
Yeah.
A lot of that is going to go away, and they're going to start holding the cameras, whether it's on the body, in the hand, and moving those shots so that you get whole scenes. But COVID is literally going to reshape the industry in a lot of ways. I mean, I'm seeing it now.
Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely. I believe that.
Not only that, I'm still looking for those producers and writers that are going to write. We are the boomers. We've lived longer than a lot of people. I know I've lost a lot of friends, and I'm not ashamed to tell anybody my age. I never was. I'll be 71 August 3rd. I said, but when I go through the airport, and I was just telling my doctor today when I went in for a checkup, I said, well, I guess they're going to stop me even longer at the airport. He said, why? I said, because I'm already the bionic woman. I got a titanium knee, which is the strongest thing on my body. So whenever I'm going through the airport, they know, but they say, okay, Miss Payton, you know which one? I say, I got it, baby. I know which one I'm going through. Go through. I say, now they're going to pull me back and say, wait, Miss Payton, we know about the knee, but what's the other metal? In my back, I had to have back surgery. Uh-huh. And somebody gets me, said, well, who was your doctor? Oh, my God, Miss Payton, nobody would ever know. I said, nobody would know I had knee surgery because I do everything my doctors tell me to do. And I intend on being here till 102 with good sense.
Come on now.
Hey. All right. Yay.
On that great note, it breaks my heart to end this because you're amazing and amazing.
Don't end it.
Belinda,
we have nothing else, Belinda.
I owe you a thank you for taking over because I just get to watch and it's delightful.
Yeah, it's so much fun. And this is such a great panel. You're such a wonderful actress. So yay, I'm so happy to be a part of it and to be able to see my new friends.
I'm so honored to be in you guys' presence because I know what you did and I know why you did it and I know how it impacted the world. So I just feel so honored to be in your presence. Allie and Belinda, Mary-Margaret, I didn't know. Sheryl, I even did your show. And Breanne and Emily and Jennifer and everybody involved. Thank you so much because I wasn't sure I'd be able to do it. I'm glad I did.
Yeah.
Thanks, everybody. Me and everybody too. Watch their shows on all available on Hulu.
Okay.
Yay.